We're back here on the program, the Jones and Company, and we are speaking today with cartoonist, artist, Mr. Stan Burnside. And Mr. Burnside, at the break, you made a powerful point, talking about those people.
Yeah.
When we talk about our brothers and sisters from the southern part of from where we are, really. Mm. And really, Bahamians have a phobia, wouldn't you say?
We have more than a phobia. We have a streak of self-hatred that is manifest in how we can look at someone who looks exactly like us and make disparaging comments.
I call it negrophobia.
And think that we're not insulting ourselves. You know, a part of the problem is this, Mr. Jones. We have to recognize that if we were to have a sense of family, you know, that if you were African in Great Britain, you felt a part of the family of Africans, then wherever things like Haiti would happen, because it is a tragedy what's happening in Haiti. Now, so I understand billions of dollars were raised and there's no sign of any, you know what I mean?
So the tragedy continues.
The tragedy continues.
Slavery itself was a tragedy.
Slavery was a tragedy. One of the victories that we need to celebrate during that period is the defeat of Napoleon at the hands of Haitians.
Yes.
And Napoleon, you know, when you read the books, they say Napoleon was some kind of military genius. And our brothers were able to send him packing. And I don't think they ever forgave Haiti. So, you know, they just set about destroying Haiti, you know. But the amazing thing about Haiti, Mr. Jones, is that when they became independent, you know, they fought for their independence, they won it, you know. Nobody gave them their independence.
Mm-hmm.
As a part of their constitution, it reads that any individual of African ancestry, once they set foot on Haitian soil, became a Haitian citizen. You didn't know that, eh? That's a part of their constitution.
Yes, yes.
My father told me this years ago.
Yes.
And here it is now, years later, you know, when we were running away from slavery and rough treatment and we went to Haiti, my brother, you know, years later, they have problems and they run to us trying to get away from their problems. What kind of treatment are they getting? Now, I'm not suggesting that we open up our borders to everyone. I'm not suggesting that. I'm just saying that we have to put things in perspective and understand that these are our people. These are our people. You know, I believe in the family of man. I'm a fellow, my father, he raised us to see everybody as human beings, irrespective of their ethnicity.
Mm-hmm.
But when you talk about Africans, we have to find a way to come together, man.
Yes, mental slavery continues, Stan Burnside. That is the point that you are making. That there's a mental slavery that continues not only in the Bahamas, but throughout the Caribbean,
throughout the world.
Yes.
Unfortunately.
Where there's a negrophobia, a fear of black people, where black people fear themselves, where they work against themselves, where they seek to pull down themselves. That is not going to change, is it?
It has to change. Because
that's not a change in our lifetime.
Yeah, but that is not who we are, Mr. Jones. That is not who we are.
I'm sure.
You know,
What can bring about the change? We have known of the Haitian story. We know how they got their independence. There is a class of Haitians who don't like the other class of Haitians,
mm-hmm.
black
mm-hmm.
Haitians or the mulatto ones,
mm-hmm.
who have a difficulty with the darker skin ones,
mm-hmm.
and so there is class consciousness, even in the Bahamas,
mm-hmm.
where the darker you are, Stan Burnside, the more difficulty you get in some quarters.
Unless you have money.
Unless you have money.
Okay.
Now, how do you fix that? Because I'm talking about mental slavery now.
Yeah, yeah. I think you make the issue a lot more complicated than it needs to be, you know? I think that we can get to the details of how to fix it, but we first have to acknowledge that it is wrong to look at your brother and sister and think of them as being different than you are. You know, we have to acknowledge that. Once we acknowledge that, and once we accept that that is a fact, it is a fact that if you, Mr. Jones, went to New York City right now and you stood outside a building trying to get a cab, you wouldn't have a better chance of getting a cab than any other black man born in New York City. That's a fact.
Yes.
If you went to Ferguson...
I've experienced it.
If you went to Ferguson, you would have been shot down at that age, even if you were Bahamian just visiting. You know? So we have to recognize that there is an experience that we have as African people that is common everywhere in the world. You know, I admire the Jewish community so much, you know? And a lot of people think that the Jewish community, this monolithic kind of phenomena, but you have a lot of different kinds of Jews who believe different things and who fight each other and you know? But when it comes to their Jewness, they are one.
Who are your heroes, Stan Burnside?
And
who are the people you have admired, even in the Bahamas?
Oh, man, I have so many heroes. One of my heroes is, and probably my greatest hero, is my father. My father is someone who grew up on the Family Islands. You know, his father was a commissioner, so he visited many Family Islands and lived in many Family Island communities. And when he came to Nassau and, you know, he had his education and he went off and he became a dentist, he never lost that islandness in him. And so I tell the story many times of my father who would come home sometimes and my mother would ask him from the dentist office.
Mm-hmm.
My mother would ask him, where's the money? And he would come home with a big box of sapodillas and, you know, gneps, yeah, and all the rest of it, you know what I mean? Because
yes.
People would come from the Family Islands and they didn't have any funds. And all they had was some fish, a turtle, or this or that. And he was happy when my mother finally went to his office and looked at his books. I remember the time there was over $200,000 owed to him by his patients.
And that was good money at the time.
In those days, that was a fortune.
Yes.
But that's who my father was. And many people, you know, we call my father Mr. Burnside. I said, Dad, you worked hard to be. He says, Son, what is my name?
Yes.
You know?
Absolutely. You know, Stan, we are out of time. And
you're kidding me.
I'm not kidding.
I talk too much,
no,
man.
No,
I talk too much.
But you were quite insightful and quite quite educational.
We didn't even get to talk about what I wanted to talk about.
You have to come back.
I'll be back. I'll bring my work next time.
Absolutely. Bring your work next time. Yeah. And I'd like to run some of the work or the tribute that you did to your brother, Jackson Burnside, at the end of this program.
Well, this is a short video edited by my daughter from photographs that Roland Rose took of an exhibition that I did in tribute to Jackson.
Very good. Yeah. Well, thank you again for being here. And I hope that our
viewers enjoy the tribute. I didn't talk your head off.
No, come back soon.
Yeah, I enjoyed it.
Thank you for watching and listening to our program today. Good evening, everyone.
Sing.